course coordinator for this session will be Dr. Venkatesh. He is fortunately the nephrologist of our hospital also, beyond which he has plenty of interest. A man of principle, a man of, you can see the way he talks, he doesn't get budged by anything, very evidence-based. He will follow what is there in the book. He will not budge to anything, no pharma influence, nothing. Great human being. He will be always for the patient. If some patient resists, he will make sure that what is best for the patient is being carried out. He's not like something like some of us, like we will say, like we always listen to what patient thinks, what patient says. We always budge to what patient needs, but he is one person. He will make sure that what is being technical, what is being needed, is being taken care to the patient. Such a great human being, great doctor, great person. I hand over the mic to Dr. Venkatesh for the further session.
Yeah. I think Gaurishankar has given, whatever he said, please discount that. Nothing of the, I mean, we have a very great relationship. Being a friend, he probably was saying a lot of stuff. So let's start off with, I think we can start, I think most of you are ready. I think we'll go ahead with it because we're running, as he rightly said, we are short of time with 30 minutes. So we'll start with our introduction of our nephrologist for the day. So all of you have met Dr. Shivalingam as well as Dr. Sharita, my esteemed colleagues, two very eminent nephrologists in the city with considerable amount of experience, both national as well as international. And please feel free to ask any number of questions within the time permitted by Gaurishankar so that we can make this session more a dialogue rather than a monologue. So that's what we want to see. So basically three of us, we work together. We are part of this group. This group is directed by Dr. Sarita. And in the group, the three of us try to do something within the Chennai city. So what is this? What this group aims for? What the three nephrologists together? See, the ratio of patient population to nephrologist in Chennai, in generally in India, is you know, for every 1.6 million Indians, we have one kidney specialist in the country. This is the data from the Indian chapter of the Indian Society of Nephrology. So this is what we do in Chennai. So we have three different types of programs. One where we try to teach people about the preventive care in kidney, and we call that program as Kidney for Life. And the next one is we try to generate more number of dialysis technologists as well as nurses who are trained in taking care of the renal failure patients. We call that program as Train for Life. And the fourth one, the third one is what we try to do is we try to teach alternative systems, especially physical rehabilitation, lifestyle modification. We use yoga. This is something which we try to do in our setup. So this is our group's name. This is Vijay Ganga Specialty Care Nephrology Group. Why I'm giving this information? This information is not some kind of advertisement for us. This information is only for you people to understand that it is possible for people, especially doctors, to work together to form a group. So this is our patient support group in the VGSC. This is a program that you may not have seen come across in many hospitals. These are our own dialysis patients, and they are our biggest educators. These people go and, for example, here is one of Dr. Sarita's patient who's actually counseling. So they counseled most of their patients. It's much easier to teach about a bad disease to a person by the person who suffers from the disease. So basically that is what we try to use, patient support group. And this is part of a Training for Life. This is the first of its kind program in South India. We have a Bonant approved, those of you are familiar with some the nephrology world, training a dialysis technician. Most dialysis centers are equipped with people who are either certified or people who are 10 standard dropouts or 12 standard dropouts who have been associated with the nephrologist for a very long time and they go on to do dialysis. But here it's a structured program which is an internationally approved program, the first of its kind in South India. And this particular program aims at creating dialysis technologists where they can play or assist a nephrologist or even play a nephrologist when the time is appropriate. So this is a part of our program. And this is another important thing that we do at the as a group. This is the Doctor Public Society Contact Program. So what do we do here? You can look at the topic, for example, which has been chosen. very provocative topic, how not to go to a doctor series. I mean, why would we ask people not to come to us? Certainly, we want more people to come to us, but still, that's a matter of great concern for each one of us. Less number of patients, we'll be able to concentrate and do more quality work, and that is one of the reasons why we would like to do that. So this is one of the first talks that were organized once the group was founded. The group was founded in 2012, and Dr. Sarita has been having a very very well-structured program in our own clinic, which we call the Vijay Ganga Specialty Care, which is located in near BMC in our gardens, which is near Arwarpet. So if you look at it, what we have done as a group right from 2012, from 2015, you would see a lot of things have been achieved over a period of time. On an everyday, when we call a World Kidney Day or any particular day of relevance, we always ensure that there is patient education program, doctor education program, and try to take nephrology to primary care physicians as well as the people who are interested in nephrology. The purpose is India cannot afford kidney disease. That is the reason. So therefore, we need more people who are outside the academic curve. So we all stop reading at a certain point of time, right? Once we leave the medical colleges, and our reading also goes through the window. So these kind of CMAs, and especially exposure to nephrology, is something which we wanted to do for a very long time. And all the three of us are very passionate about it. Dr. Shivalingam has got excellent oratorical skills. Sir is an academician. He is an MRCP examiner. And he was trained in the UK. He was a nephrologist from UK. He was in UK for a very long time. And basically, he's from Trinulli Medical College. So you can talk to him at any point of time. You catch him, ask him very troubling questions, and we'll be more than happy to answer. And Dr. Sarita, she did her medicine again in India. She's from Karnataka. She did from Hubli. And she went on to train her nephrology from the Cleveland Clinics. And most of you would have known Cleveland Clinics for its cardiology. But Cleveland Clinics actually is well known for its nephrology. So it's rated as one of the top five nephrology hospitals in the US. So please make use of their expertise. I mean, the advantage is when you have best of the both, when you have the East as well as the West, and you also know how to handle your problems at the grassroots level, it becomes very easier for us to give a suggestion. So this is a program that we have recently started. And today our presence in Bridge, thanks to Gauri Shankar, our presence to Bridge today is because of this, nephrology made easy. So what we are trying to do is, we are organizing a series of talks on a periodic basis within the city, with help from the industry people, as well as help from Dr. Sarita's own trust, which also helps in managing this. So what we intend to do here is, we intend to create more awareness about nephrology, before actually nephrologists get to see a patient. So that is the purpose of this. So in due course of time, I hope you all have given your registration numbers and to people. So we will send you information as and when required, depending on for the topics of interest. You can suggest topics of interest to us so that we can make sure that we can have a very informal, out of the class kind of discussion. So that's easier for all of us to have something about it. Now. I am Venkatesh, as Gauri Shankar said, and I studied my undergraduate from Tanjavur Medical College. I did my internal medicine from Manipal Academy of Higher Education, and I got trained in Apollo under Dr. Mani. So all of us have been practicing, and both Dr. Shivalingam and Dr. Sarita are senior to me. They are practicing for more than 10 years here. Dr. Sarita has more than 10 years of experience in Chennai. She's an academician. She was with SRMC. She was with some big nephrology names within the city. Herself is a very eminent nephrologist. And our interest is primarily preventive nephrology and taking care of chronic renal failure patients on dialysis. So these are two major areas where she concentrates. Dr. Shivalingam, his area of interest is very vast. Actually, at the end of his session, when he presents on the topic on hyponatremia, then we will discuss about that. So with that, we'll straight away. Today, the agenda for today is, we are going to have three sessions. One is we are going to lay the foundation of what is chronic kidney disease, which I will be talking about it. And after that, what is the role of the glomerular filtration rate, and how should a modern practitioner or a modern doctor should understand about it? What are its merits and demerits? That will be discussed by Dr. Sarita. Then Dr. Shivalingam will address a very common clinical problem that we come across in the hospitals or even in as outpatient clinics, that is hyponatremia. Many number of times you read about hyponatremia or you look at hyponatremia or you manage hyponatremia, still there is always plenty of stuff to learn about hyponatremia. Dr. Shivalingam will give you an excellent presentation on that. And during the course of the talk, we would ideally, the traditional model is after the talk is over, then we open the audience for a discussion. Would you want to happen that way, or shall we have something halfway through the presentation? Would you want to interrupt us and then ask a question? Which would be better for you people? How many of you would want to have a discussion as the presentation is going on, or at the end of the at the end? So I think most of you would prefer to have it at the end. So please make note of whatever questions that you would like to ask us. Time is not a problem. Even if Gaurishankar is not going to allow us to continue on stage, we can discuss it outside as well. So that shouldn't be an issue. So with that, we'll start off with the first topic, and I'll be talking about the first topic. This is something which I forgot, which I want to tell you. This is the reason why the three of us are together. Right, most of us are together. The purpose is not treating many patients. The purpose is to meet as many number of people as possible. See, as doctors, the society looks at us in a very different light these days. The people with two horns, whether it is satanic or non-satanic, it's a different area of interpretation. But we are not approachable. The idea is we are not approachable to the common man, or we are not approachable to our own colleagues. That should break. So that is the reason. So our basic aim was to touch as many lives as possible. Either way, either you discuss, be a good human being, talk to them about nephrology, make a living. And this, we all have this journey, and we have this wonderful opportunity, be doctors, to meet across a lot of people, and we want to enjoy this journey. And this is the reason why Dr. Sarita, Dr. Shivalingam, and me, in the first place, we all came together. In the second presentation. இதில் வந்து இதில் போட்டிருக்கீங்க அது அந்த ஐஐடி டாட் பிபிடினு இருக்கும் பாருங்க ஐஐடி ஸ்லைட் ஷோ போட வேண்டாம் அந்த ஸ்லைட் நானே சேஞ்ச் பண்ணிக்கிறேன்
ஸ்லைட் ஷோ போட வேண்டாம்
போட வேண்டாம் நான் ஐல் சேஞ்ச் இட் ஸ்லைட் ஒன் பை ஒன்
இப்படி
ஆ சரி சரி இல்லை சுவிட்ச் ஆன் ஐல் சேஞ்ச் ஸ்லைட் ஷோ சாரி அபவுட் தட் ஸ்லைட் ஓகே நவ திஸ் இஸ் யுவர் த கிட்னி தட் வி சீ ஒன்ஸ் யூ மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் அஸ் வுட் ஹவ் நாட் சீன் திஸ் இன் த சென்ஸ் தட் ஆஃப்டர் your anatomy sessions, this is what commonly we see when you open up a cadaver for harvesting an organ. And incidentally, Tamil Nadu is the nation, Tamil Nadu has been rated as the first, or let's say the organ transplantation from deceased donors, Tamil Nadu ranks number one, largely to the efforts because of Dr. Amalur Pavanathan Joseph, who is the director of vascular surgery in Madras Medical College. This is a predominantly government-driven program where it runs corruption-free for a very big change, where the doctors have zero monetary benefits. And the people who are heading this program and running this program successfully, they have put Tamil Nadu in the map of the deceased donor organ transplantation circuit because of this. And whatever we come across in the popular media that, you know, people have stolen kidneys, et cetera, please discount all those things. Those are all nonsense. For a change, we'll have a very positive thinking. And Tamil Nadu ranks number one. And those of you who do not know this, the first deceased donor organ transplantation donor was the son of a doctor couple. He had a road traffic accident and he died and the organs were given. That was the impetus. And from that time onwards, in the past 2 years, Tamil Nadu has been consistently outperforming in deceased donor organ transplant. So this is a very important development in nephrology. So something which I wanted to share with you. Now, you all know this is a very light microscopic view at a very low power magnification. This slide, I often use it for my patients to explain to them what is actually within the kidney and what the kidney actually does. So you see these small globular structures, they are your nephrons. And you find as time progresses, the nephron size becomes smaller. And sometimes some of these nephrons are completely shrunken and they disappear. So if you find this biopsy specimen, you'll find nephrons in large number of large portion, but to a large extent, as time progresses, the nephrons die and they form a scar. So this is how the contraction happens. So this is what we call as the nephron mass. So we are all born with about 1 million nephrons in each kidney. And as time progresses, the number of nephrons within each kidney progressively keeps coming down. So it can happen because of aging, or it can happen because of disease process. So today what I'm going to talk about is this. What is chronic kidney disease? How you identify it? And how do you classify it? And what is the medical burden of this condition? Most importantly, what is the economic burden of this condition? And who should be taking the lead in identifying this amongst the doctors' community? And of course, we will not discuss the latter two. So what is chronic kidney disease? Chronic kidney disease, to most of us, anything that in medicine is lasting for more than a few weeks or a few months, we call it as chronic. So for example, chronic bronchitis, if somebody has got a chronic cough for more than 3 weeks, we call it as chronic cough. Somebody has got a back pain for more than 48 hours, we call it as a chronic back pain. If somebody has got hyponatremia for more than 48 hours, we call it as chronic hyponatremia. So we have a time frame for everything. Like that, if somebody has got an abnormal kidney function, which is estimated using your GFR, lasting less than 60 mils per minute per 1.73 meter square body surface area for more than 3 months, then you call this patient as having chronic kidney disease. So if you have somebody who's got acute kidney injury, and even after the end of 3 months, his creatinine remains high, or GFR remains subnormal, then this person has got chronic kidney disease, or from the acute kidney injury phase, he has gone on to a chronic kidney phase. Apart from this, structural abnormalities within the kidney, small kidneys, congenital small kidneys, kidneys with cysts, they are also by definition chronic kidney disease. And presence of proteinuria, an evidence of kidney damage. If you use any molecule, for example, protein in the urine, then it is a chronic kidney disease. There are new novel biomarkers are also available. If you detect these biomarkers in the urine, of course they have not been incorporated into this definition, but an extension of that idea is it is called as chronic kidney disease. Now, who are the people? So now we are living in a modern era where we have this at-risk approach. So we don't diagnose disease just like that. We always look at whether there is a sufficient conducive environment for somebody to develop a particular condition. So we are looking for risk factors. And some of the common risk factors that you come across here is hypertension, diabetes, 60 years, family history of chronic kidney disease, and people who are abusing nephrotoxic drugs, especially non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents, and some forms of alternative therapies. We all know that 30 to 40% of drugs which are available from scientific medicine, I don't call it allopathic medicine, we have drugs are spurious in the market, where we have strong regulatory authorities. Then you can imagine about Ayush, you can imagine about Ayurvedic practitioners, Siddha practitioners, they might be doing a fairly good job, but the process of manufacturing of medications, drugs, their shelf life is all not very well controlled. We really don't know what is there in them. And therefore, using alternative drugs also time and again causes problems to the kidney. So that is one thing that we have to bear in mind. Cardiovascular disease. If you have a heart disease, you're prone to develop kidney disease. If you have kidney disease, you're more likely to have an heart disease. So autoimmune disorders, urological conditions, and so on and so forth. Now, what is meant by a declining function on the kidney? So when you look at presence of proteinuria, albuminuria, and a decline in GFR, as determined by serum creatinine, and more precisely by GFR estimation, only then we say somebody has got a subnormal kidney function. So how do you detect kidney failure or a problem within the kidney? How do you detect that? I would like some answers from the audience. How do you, you want to know whether a particular individual has got a kidney problem or not. How do you diagnose that? Urea, creatinine, GFR. No urine. So I would prefer the urine first. Most of the time, a simple urine examination is what is missed. And that sadly happens even in academic circumstances. People might be having kidney failure and you go about looking in the chart, where is the urine, where is the urine? People say there is no urine routine. But please make sure that urine is very important. And none of this, so basically the evaluation of the kidney function is biochemical or by using a test. We can't diagnose it clinically. And by the time if you make a clinical diagnosis of full-blown renal failure, most of your patients in stage 5. So that is something which we also have to bear in mind. So these are the spectrum of investigation nephrology. Probably if you can't make a diagnosis, of course it's my personal opinion, with this 5 sets of investigations in nephrology, you're very unlikely to make a diagnosis later. So you have a blood urea nitrogen, you have a creatinine, you estimate the GFR, and you do an analysis of the urine, you look for protein, presence of blood in the urine, then imaging of the kidneys, either by ultrasound or other methods. And finally, you do a renal biopsy if it is clearly indicated. So most of the time, with this small sets of investigation, we will be able to answer several important questions when it comes to the kidney. We will be able to say whether there is a kidney disease, whether this kidney disease is stable, whether this kidney disease is curable, whether this kidney disease is going to progress, whether this kidney, when, at what point of time is this patient going to reach a stage where he is going to be started on dialysis or a kidney transplant. All this information can be obtained from this single test called the renal biopsy. So that's the value of renal biopsy. So this is another obvious question. The part of these slides actually I showed to my patients when they make a first presentation to me in the clinic. I show them these slides. Actually, the same stuff which I'm talking here is what I also talk to the patients, irrespective of their literary background. You try to communicate in a way that they can understand. Now, what are the common signs and symptoms that we normally see in chronic kidney disease? Most of us would say edema. Anything else beyond edema? So we can think of a couple of signs and symptoms, but in reality, this is what happens. A large majority of them actually have no sign and symptom. By the time you examine somebody with a chronic kidney disease in stage 4 or stage 5, it would be very obvious. Stage 3, for example, you find that majority of them will have edema, some degree of hypertension. Diagnosing chronic kidney disease in an asymptomatic stage is probably the most important rule. So assume everybody with the given risk factors at any given point of time, the previous slide which I showed you, to have a chronic kidney disease, do the preliminary tests, which has been urea creatinine and urine routine. How many of you, when you do an assessment for the kidney function, you ask for a urea creatinine alone? What would you like to order apart from a urea creatinine for a patient who is suspected to have kidney disease? Most of the time that is forgotten. We forget to check a sodium or a potassium. If you go to an academic institute, the first thing they do is check urea creatinine. They forget the potassium. And the urea creatinine turns out to be very abnormal. The first fear is hyperkalemia, or first fear is hyponatremia. You don't know whether these two are there. So please, whenever you're in your practice, always incorporate to check your sodium and potassium. They don't cost much, right? And urea, creatinine, sodium, potassium, and hemoglobin, the four are probably the simplest way of looking at somebody's kidney disease. Somebody's got anemia, somebody's got abnormal GFR, more likely to have chronic kidney disease. So by the time somebody reaches stage 5, we have a whole, textbooks of nephrology keep talking about these classical symptoms. You'll find a whole lot of problems: fatigue, weakness, itching, bruisability, changes in the taste, dyspnea, restless leg syndrome, stuff like that. So you can like a lot of book chapters. Practically every system is affected. We don't want our patients to get to this point. We want to pick them in the asymptomatic stage, and we want to prevent them from getting these symptoms. So that is the purpose of preventive nephrology. And preventive nephrology is not a very fascinating field for a lot of nephrologists. You know why is that? What would be the reason why many nephrologists don't, you hardly find a doctor who spends about 1 hour with their patients. And Dr. Saritha, she will never leave her patients until they understand what the problem is. She will spend at least 45 minutes, minimum 45 minutes with her patients. I'm sure Dr. Shivalingam will also be doing the same. Why would that? But majority of the doctors would not do that. They spend not more than 15 minutes. So why preventive nephrology is not fascinating for nephrologists is because... Absolutely. So the basic idea is prevention, and this country cannot afford renal diseases. Prevention and prevention and prevention. And prevention is not very fascinating for the doctors because there is no money in it. Right? Very simple. Let's call a spade a spade. Simply, there is no money in it. You spend 15 minutes, you'll get the same 300 rupees or 200 rupees. You spend 1 hour, you're going to get the same 300 rupees or 200 rupees. It's not going to make any difference to us. And probably your patients who are waiting away are going to walk away. But we cannot afford to do this in our practice as doctors. It is important in this era that we focus and spend enough amount of time to communicate to the patients in their own language about the importance of prevention. And that starts with lifestyle, diabetes control, hypertension control, lifestyle modification. And sadly, in our country, patients want to hear everything from the horse's mouth. Right? So if you may have a very well-trained physician assistant who can talk beautifully about hypertension control, but even at the end of the lecture, your patient will come back to and ask you whether it's okay or not. You give a prescription. Please, sir, go ahead. Absolutely, what sir is pointing out, in please sir, please go ahead, sorry.
The message reached because I'm taking you to a lateral thinking. You can answer. It's a direct question to all of you. Yeah, which mass media? Which cinema? Competent to talk about it. That's a direct question. So I am in the field of public health. for the past 30 years and I have piloted the most of the program as the country is experiencing today. I am an authority on the subject and we are going to have a Chennai chapter of public health because this is the most ignored area. As you told, the preventive aspect of dengue, chikungunya, nobody bothers. There are so many corporate hospitals, who bothers about all these things? Okay, how it reached? How is the mental retardation? Like that, I want, because Sivalingam, who is Sivalingam? I am from Tirunelveli Medical College, my dear. So that way I am attached to you. Have it reached? I leave it to you.
I hope sir doesn't drag you, sir. Okay. So this is what we are all talking about. We want voices. Okay. We want people to talk. And what he has said is absolutely a very important pointer. Please understand, there are so many disorders, not just disability, mental retardation, rehabilitation, physical rehabilitation, cerebral palsy, for example, neurological rehabilitation, myotonic dystrophies, patients with muscular dystrophy, and the same category, we have this burden of non-communicable disease in our country. And as he rightly pointed out, you have a large workforce to work for certain types of diseases where the message can be taken to the masses. But what about diabetes? What about hypertension? What about management of chronic kidney disease? One common problem that we encounter is you write a prescription and you don't have time to talk to the family about explaining the dose, frequency, etc. And you have a very well trained physician assistant and they're going to explain everything to them. Still, the patient would come back and say, is everything is all right? I mean, this is what she told me. Is it fine? So that is what we need. So basically what has happened in 40 years is in India, treatment and medical care has become physician-centric. So it is that's something which you have to move away. We have to move away from that. Hospitals, yes. So that is something which is very important. And when you have the perspective of working abroad, and I learned a lot of this stuff from looking at Dr. Sarita's work and Dr. Shivalingam's work, it's not something which I learned when I was in Tanjore Medical College. So it is important that we have to involve people, more number of people, preferably with non-medical background in the preventive area of nephrology. But then I'm digressing. The point which I was trying to tell you is preventive nephrology means talking. Preventive nephrology means counseling. Preventive nephrology means explanation. Preventive nephrology means explaining to them everything at every point of time, right from salt to water to everything. Any question, any number of questions they ask. But most of us would not spend that degree of time because primarily we have other stuff. But probably it is not, we don't have much greater incentive to do that. So now let's come to this very important question. So you order for a creatinine for looking at the kidney function test of a patient and you find the creatinine to be 1.3. How many of you would think this is normal? How many of you would think it is abnormal? Okay, so that is an important message. Creatinine per se will not tell you whether the kidneys are normal or abnormal. So what you need to look at is the context in which it is happening. So creatinine is generated from the muscle. Every day creatinine is produced in the muscle and it gets excreted by the kidney. And creatinine is only one of the molecule which accumulates in the blood whenever there is a problem in your GFR. So that is one of the reason why GFR is more important in assessing kidney function rather than depending upon a single biological molecule, creatinine, which is produced in the muscle. So let's say, for example, this person who's got no limb, the creatinine of 1.3 is certainly abnormal for him. And because he has less muscle mass, but the amount of creatinine he's generating is actually high for his age. But if you look at a bodybuilder like this in the West, you know, in Philadelphia, when I saw a couple of African Americans, when I looked at them, I thought, I had to look from top to bottom, they're huge people, big muscle. So these guys, they tend to have slightly higher creatinine, especially the African Americans. And you find, for example, the same 1.3 creatinine in a woman, of this frail woman with no muscle mass, she having a creatinine of 1.3 is certainly abnormal. Similarly, if you take these two categories, it may be normal for this obese man, but abnormal for her. So this is something which you have to bear in mind. Now the context is also important. A creatinine of 1.3 in a woman who is 36 weeks of gestation, is that normal or abnormal? It is certainly abnormal because we all know that in pregnancy, there is a dilution that happens and mid-trimester, you find the creatinine has to be actually low. If a newborn child with a creatinine of 0.8, is it normal or abnormal? It is abnormal for that age. So age, the factors that determine whether your creatinine is normal or abnormal is not the number. It is determined by the age, it is determined by the sex, it is determined by the muscle mass, it is determined by the amount of muscle mass you have, and it is also determined by the race, and it also depends on the prior value. So that brings us to a very interesting question. Let's say, for example, somebody's creatinine is 0.8 3 days ago, and then for some reason somebody repeats the creatinine. Later on they find the 3 days later the creatinine to be 1.3. And there is another patient whose creatinine is 2. And a few days later, the creatinine was found to be 4. Who has got the severe kidney failure in this category? 0.8 to 1.3 is one of the answers. Why that happens? Why would you say that? I mean, if you assume that 1.3 is normal, most of the time this happens in our hospital. We do a test, we miss this small change in creatinine. 0.3 to 0.5 milligram percentage change from the baseline, we often miss it. So if you have a creatinine of 0.8 and it moves to 1.6, it means the patient's glomerular filtration rate has dropped by 50%. You know, when there's a doubling of creatinine, if there's a drop in the glomerular filtration rate by 50%. In other words, effectively you lost one function of one kidney. That's what, I mean, figuratively speaking. But if you have somebody who's got a subnormal GFR, somebody with a creatinine of 2, their GFR may be something like 40. And for them, by the time the creatinine goes up to 4, you'd have lost the 50% reduction GFR happens. So it comes to 20. So from 40 to 20, 20 ml of GFR is lost. But if somebody's creatinine is 0.8, the person's GFR is likely to be 120 ml. And when it doubles, it comes to 60 ml. So this person has lost 60 ml of the GFR. So basically looking at kidney failure is not based on creatinine. Looking at kidney failure is based on the context. It's based on the risk factor. It is based on estimation of your GFR. And today, if there is one particular message that we want you people to take home and remember and use it in your practices, is what Dr. Saritha is going to elaborate later on about the use of glomerular filtration rate, or how do you estimate and how do you use it, its merits and demerits. So this is the graphical representation of the concept that I told you. Whenever there is a doubling of creatinine, GFR drops by 50%. So prior value is always important. To know whether somebody has got a kidney disease or not, please ask them what was the previous creatinine. Please look at old records from 10 years ago or 5 years ago or 3 years ago. So those of you who have worked with nephrologists, you would know that every time a nephrologist calls for somebody comes and say patient has got a creatinine of 1.3, the first question most of us would ask is what was the past creatinine. So that is a very important thing. So a baseline creatinine value is important even in evaluating anybody with chronic kidney disease. So how do we classify? So having said that, we are going to calculate GFR. And how we are going to calculate the GFR, that Dr. Saritha will give you a very beautiful way of doing that. But once you have calculated the glomerular filtration rate, then you can actually classify the chronic kidney disease based on the GFR into 5 stages. Now this is a very beautiful slide. I like this slide because of the following reason. See, the iceberg is submerged. The 4/5 is underwater and the 1/5 is above water. So what you can see above is actually innocuous, but what you see below is quite dangerous. So basically, we need to figure out the iceberg here. That basically, we have to pick it up from stage 2 or stage 3. Then we can do something about it to prevent its progression to stage 4 and stage 5. So that is the purpose of identifying it early. So because chronic kidney disease is an asymptomatic condition, and if you estimate through your GFR, almost always you will be able to classify people much early and then do whatever is necessary. So we all know that the global burden of diabetes and hypertension is enormous. And because diabetes and hypertension is enormous, we also find the end organ damage is also enormous. And kidney is not an exception. So that reminds me of a small anecdote when in 2003, my professor of cardiology's daughters were getting married. Both of them were getting married at the same time. And both of them were getting married to a nephrologist. Two of them were nephrologists. That was quite surprising. I mean, I was looking at 20 years ago, I mean, 10 years ago, even now nephrology is a rare species. 10 years ago, it is even rarer. To catch hold of two nephrologists for both his daughters was a big deal. So I just asked him, so what's the idea behind this? So he said, see, because of better cardiovascular interventions and primary care, more and more number of people are living longer. They're not dying, they're living longer. So they are going to live long enough to develop kidney disease. And therefore, I'm happy my son-in-laws are nephrologists, you know. So that's very important. So that is the point that we need to try to capture. So basically, 40% of CKD is because of diabetes, 27% is because of hypertension. Put together, 67% of the burden of chronic kidney disease is because of these two entities. And India, this 11%, 4%, 18%, these are all immaterial. It's all, you know, they are very small when compared to this big chunk. So world over, this is, a very crowded slide, but what it tells you is, world over, the leading cause for kidney disease is diabetes and hypertension. So for example, Malaysian population, you know, if you want to look at India, a lot of data, for example, chronic CKD, chronic kidney disease registry in India is being maintained by one of a very accomplished academician, Dr. Raja Purkar, who's a very good nephrologist. And he maintains the registry, and as nephrologists, we are supposed to gather this information data and give it to them so that, you know, we are maintaining a chronic kidney disease registry in order to actually study the prevalence of this particular, and more work needs to be done in this area. So, but I thought it will be easier to state something parallel to that. A Southeast Asian population, Malaysian population, where there are more Tamils, you'll also find that diabetic nephropathy is the leading cause for kidney disease. And what is the medical burden? Why do we need to know about the simple entity or GFR being abnormal? For what is the practical significance of that? So what happens if you develop CKD? So that is a very important question. Now, majority of them, they die even before they start dialysis. They progress to dialysis. Or somebody, they learn to live with their chronic kidney disease. This is only three aspects. So in this regard, 20 years ago, whenever you enter a nephrology ward, Dr. Mohandas was one of the oldest nephrologists in Tanjore Medical College. Whenever you go to the ward, there were always moaning and groaning in the wards. Whenever you went there, it was a sick feeling to enter the nephrology ward. So you used to say there are only three categories of nephrology patients. The sick, the sicker, and the one that is going to become sick. There were no question of health. Health was a zero when it came to fourth stage or fifth stage kidney failure. They were anemic, they were fluid overloaded, they were not able to sit, they were not able to walk, they were not able to eat. They were progressively deteriorating, they were going down. This is the kind of population that we were dealing with. Has this changed in the past 20 years? Yes, it has. It has tremendously changed. I'll show you how it has happened. Now, I said CKD, if you take a chronic kidney disease, what is likely to happen? These patients are more likely to die than progress to ESRD. In other words, there are very few people with CKD actually reach the stage 5 and they start dialysis or they go on transplant. A large majority of them actually die. They don't even live up to their stage where they can develop CKD stage 5. In fact, we say if you get to the stage in your CKD to the point where you require dialysis, you are a survivor. Right, and that creates a lot of bias in our ESRD studies later on when we do cut. We are actually looking at a relatively healthy CKD population. Relatively healthy CKD population is the one that progresses to ESRD. Because a large majority, they die even before that. They die of cardiovascular disease. 60% of the dying because of cardiovascular disease or infections. So that is the most important thing. This is what is implied. If you have diabetes, you have CKD. And this is an outpatient clinical diagnosis. If you follow them for 2 years, you will find 22% of them die. 18% of them progress to ESRD, and the number in the 2 years interval that remain event-free is very small. Now, comparatively, if the nephrologist sees the patient for the first time in an inpatient and follow them up for the next 2 years, you find that relatively the mortality for these patients is even higher. 43% die, 9% progress to ESRD, and 48%. So, when compared to the previous slide, the message here is, if a nephrologist sees the patient as outpatient, the probability of this patient progressing to ESRD comes down from 18% to 9%. So if a patient reaches a nephrologist on time, the chances of us delaying the progression to ESRD is very much high. But still, you'll also see there's a difference in mortality. If the nephrologist sees him as an outpatient, the chances of these people dying before they reach ESRD is also, when compared to later, as an inpatient when he comes and sees and later on follows up, you'll find that the mortality seems to be pretty high. In other words, when nephrologists get involved in the care of this patient at a very early stage, CKD stage 3, 4, and 5, the probability of survival, the probability of ESRD increases. But I won't vouch for all independent nephrologists, but that's a general idea. You know, I wouldn't say, for example, a patient may not survive if he comes to me. I may be a very bad nephrologist, but if he goes to Dr. Sarita, probably has got a better chance of survival. So that is something which you people have to clearly understand. So, but you know, to a large extent, the idea is, nephrologists, if they get involved early in the care, it makes a difference to their life. But is it possible for us to do that? And that is where the knowledge of nephrology has to be disseminated at all levels. People have to learn to diagnose CKD, people have to learn to intervene in CKD, and people should know when this person actually requires a nephrologist care. So when would you refer a patient to a nephrologist? You're having a patient whose creatinine is 1.5. Would you refer the patient to a nephrologist? You have a patient whose creatinine is 1.3. Would you refer the patient to a nephrologist? If you have a patient whose GFR is, let's say, 80 ml, would you refer the patient to a nephrologist? If you have a patient whose GFR is 30 ml, would you refer the patient to a nephrologist? So what are the criteria that we use for referring a patient to a nephrologist is based on your GFR. So if you use GFR as a criteria for referring it to a nephrologist, what are likely to happen? So the question is early intervention. So how early should a nephrologist be able to see a patient? So we will discuss that at the end of the session. So The medical burden is enormous. See, a large majority of these people, whether male or female, across communities, they die. They have a large cardiovascular burden, they die. Apart from this, they also develop stroke, they also develop heart disease, they develop cardiovascular problems, coronary problems, they develop problems with pertaining to the feet. One of the most neglected part in the human body is the feet, especially for us, for Indians, especially in the rural communities as well as even in urban areas. You find we don't have this habit of clipping our nails or washing our nails or cleaning our toes or looking in between the webs of our feet. How many of us do that? We all wear socks, we all wear shoes, we go back, we just throw it, we just wash and then go. We don't examine what is in between our webs, right? Most of us don't actually look at it. So this morbidity, diabetic foot and diabetic foot syndrome is probably a much bigger morbidity when compared to chronic kidney disease. Retinopathy, people who have got problems in the retina. So these are some of the comorbidities with which they have to live with. So increasingly from 1980 to 2003, we find a large number of people are starting on dialysis. A large number of people are surviving. A large number of people are starting on dialysis and the burden of CKD is going up. Now, for example, this is a patient of mine who comes all the way from Malaysia. For 6 months, he's in Malaysia. For 6 months, he's in India because his son is married to an Indian girl. The Malaysian government sent me a letter, interestingly, saying that you please continue dialysis in India itself because the Malaysian government pays for the dialysis. And they found the payment for India is actually cheaper. They thought that it's easier if this guy stays in India and undergoes dialysis, we can pay less for him. And in fact, that's why this man lives for 6 months in Malaysia and 6 months here. So he comes for dialysis and surprisingly, he started dialysis at the age of 72. Now this man's age is 89. And he has survived for so long. He has undergone a bypass surgery. He has undergone a removal of his gallbladder. He has had over two or three of his toes amputated. He had one stroke episode from which he has survived. But he is one of the most cheerful persons that I have ever seen. Whenever he comes, in this bag, he keeps a couple of books and he asks people to read. He's blind in one of his eyes, so an assistant comes along with him. He keeps reading him his book. So this is why this has happened, why dialysis has made a difference to his life. Dialysis has significantly made a difference to life. But is it a guarantee that everybody who starts dialysis is likely to live longer? Certainly not. But can dialysis prolong people's life? Certainly, yes. But what is the objective of doing a dialysis or in a stage by kidney failure? The objective is to provide them a good quality of life. To a large extent, you can consider dialysis as some kind of a palliative therapy. The purpose is to make them economically productive, to make them more independent. You don't want them to be lying down at home with anemia, with a lot of suffering and all that. So the purpose of dialysis is to create a good quality of life. So what is the economic burden of this particular problem? If you look at, the population that is surviving to reach ESRD is growing as years progress. And the graph is always like this. The number of people who are actually starting dialysis or going on transplant is pretty high. And you find, I've given you an example here. It is in 1997 that I encountered my first kidney failure patient in Thanjavur Medical College where the patient died very miserably and we couldn't do much about it. So that left me thinking. So I thought, what was the economic status at that time in different parts of the world? If you look at United States, $13 billion was the amount of money that was spent in 1997 by the government for providing dialysis for their patients. And Europe spent $10 billion and Japan spent $9.5 billion. How many of you know that how much is the money that the Indian government actually spends for healthcare in our country? It's roughly estimated to be 1 to 1.5% of a GDP. But how much amount of this actually goes to kidney failure patients? Do we have data on that? We don't have any data. These are some of the ongoing attempts. The CKD registry tries to address this issue. But ICMR, a lot of other government organizations have to chip in and have to kind of, you know, make this as mandatory that every disease gets reported so that we know how much amount of money is being spent. But what can we expect from a country that has effectively abdicated its responsibility in healthcare and health to private hands? Right? So the government has effectively abdicated its responsibility. Healthcare is not my problem. And it is also effectively said health education is also not my problem. So 80% of Indians have to depend on our own pocket money in order to survive. And CKD is a bad condition. It will make you, my teacher, Dr. Mani, his autobiography, he called it Emaraja's elder brother. His autobiography was called as Emaraja's elder brother. We were wondering why is he calling it as Emaraja's elder brother. So the reason why he called it as Emaraja's elder brother is a nephrologist not only, you know, takes away life, he also takes his money away in the process of trying to treat him. Because families become bankrupt over a period of time. That is why this is a very important issue. So 80% of the dialysis population in our country are from the rural areas. And you have the relative proportion of nephrologists versus patient populations. For every 1.6 million Indian, you have one kidney doctor. Most of us are in big cities. We are practicing in large renal centers. And the economic cost or imposed on a patient with CKD stage 5 every year on dialysis is close to 2 to 2.5 lakhs rupees. If you undergo a transplant, it's even higher initially, but as time progresses, it becomes lesser. And what happens to the remaining 1% of the kidney failure patients? Actually, they die. They can't afford therapy and they die. A large majority, they die within a year of establishing a diagnosis. So should we really bother about preventing kidney failure? We should. We should, as a country, we should bother about it. And who's going to do that? Nephrologists certainly are not going to do it. Most nephrologists are interested only in transplant and as well as in dialysis. But to a large extent, prevention is the key. And that is one of the reasons why we want to emphasize this time and again. And we intend to do this over a series of programs in the coming months. So let's look at how to, is it possible to retard the progression? With this slide, I think probably we will close. See, basically, starting from the age of 45 years, as we advance in age, our GFR starts dropping. So with every year, our GFR starts dropping. But when you have a disease like diabetes or hypertension, etc., the rate at which your GFR drops becomes pretty fast. So between 45 to 50 or 65 years, most of them would reach a stage where they would require dialysis. So I feel very strongly that the idea of prevention of progression of chronic kidney disease is the responsibility of everyone, not just that of the nephrologist. So in a discussion later on, we'll probably have this, we'll address this much more greater detail. But in the last 10 years, what has happened? Because of effective use of ACE inhibition, angiotensin receptor blockade, we were able to make the trajectory of this graph from no treatment to, if you treat very intensively, we can give them close to 11 years of survival, dialysis-free survival. And this has been, time and again repeated in many studies later on. I think with that, I would close the introduction to chronic kidney disease. So basically, we have looked at the economic burden of it. We looked at how GFR is used as an estimate for diagnosing kidney disease. We have looked at its classification. With that, I think we will ask Dr. Sharita to come over to the stage and probably give her presentation on how to use GFR as an effective strategy, its merits and demerits. Dr. Sharita, please.
It's a beautiful morning. It's a beautiful morning mainly because of the beautiful weather outside. I think very rarely we have that. And also beautiful audience and a beautiful day here. For which I really need to thank the organizers, Dr. Gauri Shankar, and most importantly my own colleague, Dr. Venkatesh, for asking me to be a part of this bridge. Bridge, what an apt name. It connects people and builds the gap between us. So I think this is excellent. And part of the reason I'm very excited to be here is that our motto is also to be to bridge the gap between the nephrologist and the primary care. Without you, we cannot do anything. And for all our success, it is you who leave the ground. Just to add on to Dr. Venkatesh's talk, I have been in Chennai for the past 10 years, but I think what I could achieve in 7 years is nothing when compared to the last 3.5 years since we started VGSE. And the journey has been beautiful because of the team of Dr. Shivalingam and Dr. Venkatesh. And Dr. Gauri Shankar, I support you in every single word that you used for Dr. Venkatesh as a good human being and a good doctor as well. So with this, let me go ahead with our talk. My talk is about the EGFR. I think Dr. Venkatesh has already laid a ground for us that is about the CRF. The facts of the kidney disease is that everybody agrees that the increasing prevalence of CRFs or CKDs or kidney diseases in India, and not just in India, it is worldwide, although we lead the world in this. And kidney disease is a silent killer. As Dr. Venkatesh already mentioned, people do not have any symptoms. No symptoms to last a lot of complaints which are non-specific. Therefore, people do not come with a complaint like I am having a heart chest pain or a heart pain. They don't have a kidney pain, except when you have a stone, which is not really the major problem. So kidney problem does not give any symptoms. What does it lead to? Signs. We have to look at the signs, meaning it is a doctor's responsibility to identify the kidney problem when the patient is having a risk factor. So kidney problem identification is actually the doctor's responsibility. Kidney disease is also giving you a lot of signs very early on. It's before any other problem starts. Kidney gives you signs and symptoms, basically crying out for help. Look for me. You look for me, you can prevent a lot of stuff, including your cardiac and other kidney problems as well. It is a disease multiplier, CKD. Why do we say that? Kidney is the one that maintains the atmosphere of every single cell and organ to work better. The atmosphere is maintained by the kidney. When it doesn't do very well, every organ is affected. Today's day, as Dr. Venkatesh already mentioned, majority of the patients who survive, I mean, every kidney patient is also a heart patient. Only when they survive the heart problem, they end up on dialysis. Okay, so we can identify the heart patients also if we look for the signs from the kidney. Kidney patients, as they progress to end stage, it's really financially draining, emotionally taxing, and physically challenging. I would see families who are, you know, initially first day when I started, they would come in with silk saris and, you know, gold chains and everything. Over a period of time, you see everything changing onto the cotton saris and, you know, the yellow threads coming on, especially in India. I mean, they're selling properties to keep their loved ones alive, and this could be prevented. And who has to prevent it? Only we. So it decreases, and most importantly, for any human being to be alive, you need the pride to be alive. And that is what is damaged in this. Unlike the cardiac problems, or unlike the cancer problems, people on kidney disease, they feel like they're a burden on their families. They start losing hope, and which actually complexes the situations at home as well. So kidney drains not only the resources of the family, but also the entire nation, as it's already mentioned. So the beauty of it is that it is easily recognizable and also preventable. If we cannot prevent it, we can at least slow down the progression to the ESRD. Therefore, we can do a lot of role here. So the topic of today will be to ensure that all of us know to diagnose a kidney problem and diagnose it early enough. So my outline will be to tell you the importance of GFR in the clinical practice, and mine will be mostly practical so that you can do at a bed at the bedside. What is a normal GFR? Because unless we know what's a normal GFR, we don't know what is abnormal. GFR measurement and an estimation, the available methods, which test, in whom, and at what stage. Markers of the kidney function that are other than creatinine that we're using today. EGFR, today's lab, surgeons especially, I see them ordering for an EGFR from a lab. So what does it really mean? So finally, we'll end up with the case one and case two and the summary of it. How do we recognize a kidney problem? Again, early on, as this is just to emphasize that they do not have any symptoms. And the signs could be that you could be losing protein. Kidney's function is to retain what is important to the body and not let any protein loss through the urine. So if there is any protein loss in the urine, that is an early sign. Abnormal urine activity, that means high blood cells, RBCs, WBCs, CAS in the thing, that is an active urine sediment, we call it. Or if the patient has hypertension, I mean, how many do understand, or actually first time a patient comes into us with a history of hypertension, we just go ahead and give them prescription for BP medicines. How many of us actually look into what is the cause? Because kidney can cause hypertension, and hypertension can cause the kidney worsening. So there's a relation between the two. So we should always be, it is our doctor's responsibility to label them as an essential hypertension or a secondary hypertension. So look for the kidney if that is the cause of a hypertension. Abnormal scans, like an ultrasound scan, so the master checkups today's day, so many of them seem to be coming up with the ultrasound scan through which we are actually able to diagnose certain like polycystic kidneys early on, like two or three cysts in each kidney. So that's picked up on that. Next one is a reduced or an abnormal GFR. The reason I said not reduced GFR, everybody would understand. What is an abnormal GFR? What if the GFR is like 160 ml per minute? Is that normal? Well, it is also abnormal because a higher GFR is also abnormal, especially in diabetics. We can have in the initial phases, there is a hyperfiltration. So that is also an abnormal thing. So anything, any abnormality in the GFR that need to be picked up, and ultimately decreased GFR leads on to the creatinine, and that is what we're using as a marker today. So what is in reality GFR? It is nothing but the sum of the filtration of all the functioning nephrons put together per minute. Agreed? So why is this GFR so important? Why can't we just rely upon creatinine is what our basis for the talk today. The importance is that GFR is not, it is related. The lower the GFR, there's a higher mortality and morbidity index. It increases the cardiac risk. We see patients having hypertension, and it increases the risk of stroke, blindness, and dementia. It also lowers the defense mechanisms. Not many people understand this, and that CRF patients, they do not have much of a defense mechanism. The infections are more prone in them. And they also have the erythropoietin hormone goes down, so the hemoglobin is also going to be decreased. So these patients are anemic, which again adds on to the other problems of the cardiac. And then weak bones. Bones also become weak in kidney patients. And growth, if the kidney problem is seen in the young child, their growth is affected, so you have a growth retardation. And majority of them, if left alone, are going on to ESRD. Also, GFR calculation helps us in staging the patients. So we can identify them early, because at every single stage, you have a certain problems that are coming along. And also, if you find them at a stage 4, we can pre-plan for them, so we can reduce the financial burden. Also, GFR affects the pharmacokinetics of the medicines, drugs, and the test, like CT scans or an MRI that is being done. This is the schematic representation to show you that the lower the GFR, it is indicating the higher mortality index. Patients with an acute kidney injury, any patient with a CRF, with a mild kidney problem also, are very prone for an acute kidney injury with a little bit of an insult. They also progress to CRF, and all-cause mortality, no matter, with 1.3, 1.4 creatinine, so all-cause mortality is much more when compared to a creatinine of 0.8. GFR is used to stage the kidney problem. This is again mentioned by Dr. Venkatesh. Here, the stages, and also the, depending on the amount of protein that we have, there is a progression. The green, yellow, darker yellow, and red and brown is telling the way it can progress. The lower the stage, the progression is much higher if you have more amount of protein loss. So what is normal GFR? So normal GFR is about 130, it is estimated to be about 130 ml per minute per meter square in men, and also 120 ml per minute per meter square in women. How did we derive to this? It's probably by age-old thing, that through a lot of measurements and also certain measuring techniques that were proven to be gold standard is how these numbers have been achieved. However, it changes with age, gender, and also the body build. What happens with age? With age, all of us are aging, our energy levels are decreasing, so because we attribute that to the age. Same thing is happening even at the kidney level. So 1% per year of the kidney function is decreasing after the third decade. This is also called as kidney aging. Therefore, not all low GFRs indicate that you are having a kidney disease, but especially in the elderly people. You can have a person who is perfectly healthy, no hypertension, no diabetes, but still the GFR could be low. That does not mean that the patient is having a kidney disease. However, it is very important that we know that their GFR is low, and that's because it helps us in adjusting the medications that are required in that individual. So the kidney toxicity can be avoided. So this is just to show that after the age of 30, there will be about a 1 ml drop per minute per year. So by the age of 50, they might be having something like 100. And the CRF is mentioned when you have a GRF of less than 60. In some people, we also have a decline at a much faster rate. Again, purely because of age. And why does it, and in some, there is no decline at all. Why is that seen is also explained by Stuart Kim, who have found that there are many genomes that are, that are affecting the kidney aging process. Okay, so one of the genes that was found is a gene that is encoding for an extracellular matrix protein that is MMP20. And in people who have more number of genes, they age much faster. In people who have less number of genes, their decline is little slower. This is not in our hands. However, the other things are. That is, these patients, if they have a decline in the GFR because of one reason, on top of that, if they become hypertensive, the decline is a little bit faster. If they're diabetics and hypertensives on top of an age, then the decline is much more rapid, as you can see that. So the more number of risk factors are added, then the decline is much steeper. So it is for us to identify where they are and adjust the risk factors, although we cannot do much with the aging. So how do we measure? So if GFR is that important for us to identify a kidney problem early and for us to stage them, how do we measure this? The accurate way of measuring is that the gold standard is inulin clearance, also by 125 iothalamate. These are the two methods that are very much standardized and they're the gold standards. However, when compared to coming to the practical aspect, today's day, we don't do inulin clearance at all, especially in India, that's not available. Iothalamate GFR, yes, it's available in Tamil Nadu, I think only in Vellore. And the next other things that we also have is iohexol, which is a non-radioactive material. And the other one is a technetium 99 DTPA and 51 CR EDTA. Out of these three, iohexol is again not used in India. DTPA is used very much now, and Chennai also we use this, especially we use that in donor population, and I'll tell you the pros and cons of that. The other endogenous markers that we use are the creatinine and urea. Coming to the first one, inulin, why do we not use it is because, well, for any marker to be an ideal marker or to identify the kidney problem, it has to be something that is filtered and excreted without being altered through the absorption or a secretion process, or it should not be excreted through any other means other than the kidney. Okay, so that is an ideal marker. So inulin is an ideal marker. However, it is a very difficult test to do. It is a polymer of fructose. It requires a continuous infusion with the multiple blood samples, and also the bladder has to be catheterized. It's very expensive, and it is very difficult to do it, so it's not being done. Iothalamate, this is a radioactive marker, and this is a small marker that we give subcutaneous injection, and then we draw blood test timely, and then that is used to see the radioactive readings in a specialized machine, which is quite expensive, and it needs a very trained staff. And however, this is the gold standard now, and it is being used in Chennai, in Vellore, if you want it, to CMC Vellore. Exogenous markers for GFR, the next one is also the iohexol. This is a not radioactive material, so it is better. The vials come with 1 ml and they have 1 ml in each 1 ml is equal to 300 milligrams of that, and we use about 2 to 5 ml of that to be given IV, and the blood samples are corrected again 3 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours post injection. This is a safer one, cost effective and also reliable. However, a small dose of marker and blood samples will have to be collected periodically, and samples also can be stored without the loss of accuracy. However, it is less accurate in the early stages of GFR. All of them, actually, they overestimate the GFR, iohexol. But this is being very commonly used in UK, especially in kids. The other markers, the DTPA is the most common that we use here in India. Here we use an external gamma camera which measures the isotope. It's a nuclear study. A radio isotope is given, and the uptake of that by the kidneys is taken periodically. And this actually may underestimate GFR or overestimate GFR. But it is still used because it is mainly for the differential kidney function in a donor. Because that is what is important for us. It is not for the GFR estimation, but we use it mainly for the differential kidney function. How much is the right working and how much is the left working? So we can identify which kidney can be taken out from the donor. EDTA is another one, but we don't use it as much here. It is equal to iohexol results. Little bit about the creatinine, exactly an endogenous marker. Creatinine, when we're using it as an endogenous marker, why not creatinine, but why do we want to measure GFR using a creatinine? It's because creatinine, as you know, is an end product of a skeletal muscle, creatinine phosphate. Okay, so it is affected by the muscle mass. The age is because, again, younger age group, you have less muscle mass. As a kid is growing, the muscle mass is increasing. And older age group, the muscle mass is decreasing. And in obese patients, they have, the weight is there, but the weight need not be from the muscle. So there are so many variations here. However, you should know that, again, as it is being filtered, it is a good marker, of course, because it is filtered at the glomerulus, and it is excreted. It is not reabsorbed and it is not metabolized. However, it is secreted. So creatinine is not only filtered but also secreted at the tubular level, at the distal tubules. Therefore, as the GFR comes down, the role of secretion keeps on going up. Once the GFR is like, you know, 120 ml, as the GFR decreases to 100 ml, the secretion increases a little bit. So it is trying to compensate. And as the GFR is decreased to 80, there is much more secretion happening. Therefore, the loss of creatinine is still maintained. But the GFR is, GFR is low, but the creatinine levels are maintained. Okay? But there is a saturation point that is achieved. That is, once the GFR decreases to about 50%, then there's a saturation point, so no more of the secretion can happen. So after that only you can start seeing the rise in the creatinine values, which comes to a point and proves a point that because of this compensatory phenomenon, if an individual is having one serum creatinine as their baseline, at which time they might be having 120 ml per minute GFR, the creatinine will start rising to 2, which is what we are today saying, okay, you know, if it is 0.8, then coming to 1.6, still in the lab shows you a value of 1.5 is normal. So majority of us don't even identify that as a problem. However, if their patient's GFR, creatinine baseline is 0.8. Red color, huh? Sorry. This one?
This one.
Okay, gotcha. Sorry. Yeah, so here, this is only a random number that I have given. Once the creatinine, if it is 1, equal to a 120 ml per minute GFR, by the time the creatinine goes up moderately, that is to 2, the kidney function is gone by 50%. So we end up being the bad people giving the news several of the times, because when the time patient comes in with the creatinine of 2, they were told that they only have a mild kidney problem. However, it's actually the fact that they lost 50% of their kidney function. So, and this is where we have to be more aware. And now look at this. A person comes to us saying that creatinine of 4, they say moderate increase. Now, patient starts getting alarmed only when the creatinine goes up from 4 to 8. Actual loss here is how much? Only about 15%. Whereas a 50% is lost here. So if at all we need to do something, that has to be done at this area. So we need to find out how do we diagnose them early. Creatinine, why we are not using creatinine but we are using it for an estimation is because the creatinine, as I told you, the muscle mass in an obese individual, lean individual, that is affected. There are also factors affecting the steroids can increase the creatinine generation, and also plateau, as I mentioned, it about 50% of GFR, the secretion achieves a plateau. However, in special group of patients like nephrotic syndrome patients and liver patients, we do have an increased amount of secretion of the creatinine. So that will affect our creatinine levels. So they always have a low creatinine levels. And certain drugs like Bactrim and cimetidine, they block the secretion. So in these people with normal GFR, the creatinines can be at a higher levels. Okay, and more on top of all these already existing problems in India, especially, we have the main thing is the lab problems. In a rural area, they come up with a creatinine of 0.3, 0.4, or maybe 0.8. And in a lab, standardized lab, when we check it over here, we see about 1.26 also sometimes. There is one contrast that numbers that we have seen is anywhere from 0.8 at one lab. About a month later, it is 4 creatinine. So we were wondering and breaking our heads, how come this patient went into an acute renal failure? In reality, that was actually the lab problem. None of our labs, and also nephrologists several times are cursed for asking to get the creatinine values done through a standardized labs. The reason is that it's very, very important that the lab standardizes their method of testing. And more than just the method, it is also the instrument that they are using that is important. Variabilities about the machine and the methods are the ones that are actually impeding us from diagnosing the kidney problems early on. Now, from the earlier things, you know that creatinine is not going to help us in identifying the kidney problems early. So by the time the creatinine raises, we're already in stage 3 to stage 4. So this is the reason we want to see how else we can. And it's all, creatinine is also not reliable in an acute renal failure, because even after, you know, the injury happens, by the time the creatinine, the waste product levels start increasing, it takes time. So in an acute phase, it is not. In a pregnancy, it is not reliable. It is not reliable in a liver failure or nephrotic syndrome patients because of the increased secretion. In a very young or a very old patients or obese because of the muscle mass changes, it is not reliable. So creatinine is not useful in stage 5, in stage 1, also to an extent in stage 2, but only in stage 3 and stage 4. To improve that is why we use the creatinine clearance. Creatinine clearance, because there's no secretory problems here, it is, although it is not reliable in acute renal failure again, because all these measures, this is still, we are using creatinine as a marker here. Therefore, all the problems that are there will also be here, but we can, you know, lower them to an extent. So in acute renal failure and pregnancy and liver failure and nephrotic syndrome, it is still not reliable, but it is a little bit better than the regular creatinine in this population. The problems that we are really associated here are because of the inadequate collection and also because of the secretory problems. And this is what I mentioned here. So how do we know that the person, if they have measured the creatinine clearance through the urine, whether that value is correct or not? We have to validate that by looking at on an average, in a man, we can say that about, because of their muscle mass, they secrete about 20 to 25 milligrams of creatinine per kilogram in a day should be there in the urine, 24-hour urine measurement. So always ask in a 24-hour urine, what is the total amount? What is the total amount of creatinine in that 24-hour urine? If that is accounting to 25 milligrams per kilogram in a man, and about 15 or 20 at least in a woman, then that urine sample is correct. So we can take those values for a face value. And how do we collect the urine? What is the information that we tell our patients? The way we tell them to collect is, we ask them to wake up in the morning, first urine throw in the bathroom. As you come out of the bathroom, note down the time, meaning you're starting with an empty bladder. And after that, every single time you go to the bathroom, you have to start, every single drop of it has to be put into the can. Till the next morning, the same time that you have noted from the earlier day, that day, at that point of time, pass the urine and collect it. So you complete a 24-hour urine and then give it to the lab. At that time, do the blood testing of urea and creatinine. So the way you collect it is very, very important. And after the value comes out, please ensure that that is a correct way or correct sample by checking out the creatinine in that thing. Okay, is it possible to measure the kidney function, GFR, in everybody? Not possible. So how do we bring it to the bedside? To do it to the bedside is why we are using this estimated GFR calculations. So because it's very time consuming and cumbersome is why we are coming up with the equations. The equations that today's day that are very commonly used are the Cockcroft and Gall formula, which is very, you don't need any computer with you. You can just use your regular calculator, and you can, the formula is this, that 140 minus age in years times the weight in kilogram, divide that by a 72 and the creatinine in milligram per DL. And if it's a female, adjusting it to the muscle mass, it is 0.85. This is using a 3 variables that is taking into account, that is the weight of a patient and also the age. and the sex, gender is also taken. So, however, we should always know that because it is using creatinine as its base, it is going to give you the upper value of the GFR. And the same things that, you know, if a patient is obese, and their weight is, half of it is because of the fat, that is not going to be reliable. So we really don't need an accurate measurements in many, we just need an estimation. So this is going to give you an estimation, okay? And if you want a little bit improvement, like for example, in a patient who is very thin, we can adjust it to the BSA, that is body surface area, and then that accuracy improves. And this is what we can use at a bedside in an OPD to adjust your drug dosing. So the next, I mean, still we know that the creatinine Cockcroft and Gall formula is not everything. How do we improvise that further? So by adding more and more variables, MDRD formula has been developed, wherein albumin, urea is also added on. So to improve the accuracy of this thing, and it is tested again as the patients in whom the iothalamate is measured, and it seems to be better correlating compared to the Cockcroft and Gault alone. However, both these things, MDRD is also missing out the early renal failure patients, so they have come up with this another equation called as an CKD-AP equation. This uses again the same variables as that of an MDRD. However, the way they calculate and the slope model relationship has been developed, and this seems to be doing very well or better, superior in calculating the GFR in normal or mildly decreased patients. It has a less bias, improved precision, and a greater accuracy. Again, for those who want, can go on to this thing to find out the equation. Now, the lab GFR. Today's day, everything that we're asking, what is the lab really doing? They're actually using an MDRD formula, and that is the GFR that they're giving. And majority of them, it is, based on this, oncologists are using the drug dosing for chemotherapy medications based on this EGFR. So, other than creatinine, because of all these problems that we have, do we have any other markers other than creatinine? Yes, there are two other markers that have come up, and that is a cystatin. I think many of you are also looking at this, and several labs must be coming and telling you, do a cystatin, it will help you in identifying. However, this is, what is this? Cystatin is a low molecular weight protein that is produced by all the nucleated cells. And therefore, it is supposed to be that not affected by the muscle mass. And it is relatively produced at a constant rate. It is filtered and not reabsorbed, but it is metabolized by the tubules. Okay, so diet does not alter these levels. So some of the major problems with the creatinine are overcome with this, and it is not affected by the height, gender, age, or the muscle mass. Reference values are anywhere between 0.5 to 0.9. And what is the cystatin C? This is also used in place of creatinine in an acute. It is more sensitive marker actually, especially in the early stages. So in place of creatinine, they're using a cystatin C value, coming up with an equation and saying that, oh, this patient is having an low GFR. And this is more sensitive in the early phases. It is an early, like renal failure problems, or when the GFR is more than 90, where creatinine is not raising, there the cystatin can be used. And it's also proposed by Mr. Rule, White, and Poge that it definitely helps in elderly children, cirrhotic patients, and in also critically ill patients. Later on, in 2005, more papers have come up saying, debating or contradicting the same thing. Today's day, labs are doing it, but what is the importance of that? We don't know. So it is expensive, it really doesn't change much, and it is still affected by the other things like the steroids or the thyroid values, or also in diabetic patients. We don't have a standardization, it is not easily available, and the benefit is doubtful. So promising, especially in the early, however, we're not, practicality-wise, it is not still coming up to it. The third marker that is coming up is a beta trace protein. This is a low molecular weight protein again. It is produced. It is a component of all the body fluids, and it is a tubular protein that is secreted, and it seems to be, again, independent of the height, weight, gender, age, and the muscle mass, and it is seemed to be equal to the serum creatinine as a marker for the GFR. However, It is also thought to be, it is seeming to be inferior to the cystatin C in general population with a normal GFR. But in pregnant women, it seemed to be better. More than anything, they're also seeing an association between the beta trace protein positivity and the cardiovascular disease and death marker. So it is more coming up as a marker for cardiovascular risk, just like the proteinuria. So I hope I'm able to give a little bit. So let us see on a case base how much we're able to absorb. 54-year male with a history of diabetes and hypertension. He had a regular checkup for the complaints of swelling in the feet. And his weight is about 85 kilos, and his creatinine is 2.4. Do you think he has a kidney disease? Huh? Yes? Yeah, I think this is a dummy, right? Because with the creatinine of 2.4, anybody would say, yes, they have a kidney problem. So what is the best way of estimating his GFR or measuring his GFR? What do you think? Because the creatinine is more, is about 2, we can still use the Cockcroft and Gall formula and get an so that's the equation to be used to estimate the GFR, and it correlates well. And to measure it, we can use a 24-hour creatinine clearance. What is his GFR? If you use 140 minus 54 times his weight, that is 85, divided by 72 and also 2.4, your answer is going to be around 42 ml per minute. So what do you think is his staging? Something like 3B. I mean, answer is here again. It was supposed to be covered, but it came up anyway. So case 2, 54-year-old male with no medical history wants to be a donor for his son suffering from a CKD due to a PUV and recurrent pyelonephritis. His weight is about 85 kilos and creatinine is 0.9. What do you think is the best way to estimate and measure his GFR? His creatinine is only 0.9. So which is the calculation that you want to use, and how do you want to measure his GFR? In the early phases where the creatinine is not a marker, however, we are coming up with a CKD AP equation and a 24-hour urine for creatinine clearance. And we also do a technetium 99 scan on him because he wants to be a donor, wherein we want to know the exact kidney function, the differential kidney function. So in that way, what is his kidney function coming up to be? This is by the CKD AP equation. This is by the Cockcroft and Gall formula. And this is by the nuclear scan. And he has about a 43 in one side and 57 on the other side of the left and the right kidneys. So do you think he can be a donor? Yes or no? Yes. Which kidney you want to take out from this donor and give it to the recipient? Right or left? Right? No. Any first dictum is never hurt the individual. Yeah, so it's other one. So please leave the best kidney with the donor and take out the 43 one if you want to and give it to the recipient. So in summary, GFR is very, very important in recognizing the kidney disease and also staging to choose the diagnostic modality like CT and MRI scans these days. With 1.3 creatinines, people are giving radio contrast material, which can also cause on to acute renal failure. So, and an MRI contrast is not good when the GFR is less than 15, MRI contrast causes more problems, so please don't use that. More precisely, we need a GFR to be measured only in certain degree of people, that is when they have a solitary kidney, and the progression of the disease which we want to monitor more closely, or in people in whom we are using chemotherapy drugs with a very narrow therapeutic index, or in patients who are going to be the kidney transplant donating, or if they want to be donors, or if we want to list the patient on for the transplant listing. So once the GFR is less than 15, we can register patients on the cadaveric listing so they can get the kidney early on. And at a glance, in the early stage, the markers, if you're looking at, in the early phases, it is cystatin C, and later on, creatinine. Creatinine always overestimates because of the secretion, and the equations, if you're wanting to use it, it is a CKD AP equation, and now, even better than that, we are getting is a creatinine and a cystatin equation, which both of them are put together. and we are developing an equation for that. And so it is very useful when the creatinine is less than 1.2, this is the equation. And once it is more than 1.2, you can use a Cockcroft and Gault formula to estimate. And once the creatinine is even higher, you can use an MDRD formula wherein the urea, nutrition status are all taken into account. MDRD can also be used from here to here in place of Cockcroft and Gault, but you need a computer for that, whereas here you can do it bedside. And when you want to a little bit more accurate measurements, in the first to the stage four, we can use a creatinine clearance as a measurement. And once it is a stage five, because the creatinine is too much overestimating, we want to use a urea also as a clearance. And then this is always underestimating and creatinine clearance is overestimating. So you measure both and you take the divided by two to get an average, so you can get a better understanding about the staging in the stage five. So we can plan for a fistula, we can plan for vaccination, we can plan for a PD education, and so we can save money and health and wealth on those patients. Finally, if you need an exogenous markers, only iothalamate is available right now, and DMSA scanning, DMSA only for the DTPA only for the donors, and iothalamate only when you're really wanting to know what exactly is happening. Otherwise, we don't use it as much now. So this is the current status. So which test and which patient? One more slide, last one. Normal person, less than 50 years of age for the donor evaluation. CKD epi, 24-hour urine creatinine clearance, and radionuclide scanning. In children, unlike this, we use another formula which is called a Swartz GFR estimate, and beta trace protein may be a thing that will come up in future, and iohexol that is being used in UK. And in pregnant women, may be promising is a beta trace protein, and an acute renal failure, cystatin and cystatin C based equations. In CRF, early stages and a high risk or a single kidney, we use cystatin C and CKDAP equations put together. In CRF late stages where the creatinine is more than 1.5, Cockcroft and Gault formula correlates very well with the GFR, and this can be used at a bedside and less than 70 years of age. MDRD once they are more than 70 or in the later stages. 24-hour urine for the creatinine clearance, and urea and creatinine clearance once the creatinine is more than 4. That ends my thing. Any questions? Thank you. Any questions? What are you doing later? Yes, please. Absolutely. I think the point is that with so much of variability with the labs and everything, the way I would recommend, and if it is possible, is that the minute you have a risk factors, that is, once you're diagnosed with a hypertension for the first time, or diagnosed with the diabetes for the first time, always give them the complete education, including the kidney. So after that, the nephrologist can see them only once in a year. But at least you should start right then and there so the prevention can be taken care of. Okay, the minute you diagnose a risk factor, that is, creatinine need not be very high. Creatinine can be even 0.8, but you have diabetes, then you should tell them ki you should go check out once. That is what I would practice, and this is what is a practice in abroad, US, everywhere. In India, because of lack of nephrologists or lack of accessibility, I don't know. Here, in the last few years, all I have seen is creatinines of 3 and above that I have been seeing, which is really, you know, painful. And I would prefer the kidney person to come to us the minute 1.2 also, I would like to see them. Only once, need not be very often. Okay. For an Indian female, 1 is abnormal. For an Indian male, probably 1.2 is definitely abnormal. Although the lab values give you up to 1.5, that's not true. Many labs, unfortunately, we don't have standardization in India. The ones that I have been using here are Lister's, Hi-Tech. I mean, at least you can go back to them and say, and then there's a consistency of it with them. So So it is much more, I mean, use a bigger lab, use a proper method, and only then we can get a reproducible reading. Okay, again, 0.8 to 1, if they fix it as 1, the reagent doesn't tell you that. Okay, so, and also patients who are getting, who are having this, I mean, you know, for an individual who is only about 4 feet, or an individual who is 6 feet, or an individual who is thinly built, for all of them it's the same range. So I think it is for the clinician to understand if this value is okay for this individual or not. And then if you're in doubt, go ahead, do the creatinine clearance. And whenever you do a creatinine clearance, please ensure that if that you know, urine is collected properly or not. And is it validated value or not? Absolutely right, and that is why it becomes more of an art than science. However, I think that ultimate thing is that don't use creatinine. Okay, use an equation to estimate the GFR. Okay, please don't take creatinine for its face value. If you wait for the creatinine to go up, then it is too late. So use the equation, understand how much of a risk they are. Please look for the proteinuria's and refer them early. So the drug dosing has to become much more careful in the early stages. Yes, please.
Things are not standardized when there is a gap between the practitioner and the expert.
Practitioner and the
expert in the knowledge.
And the expert.
Yeah.
No, that is where we are. All of us have to come down to an understanding.
So there are a lot of gray areas in this, and there is we have to think in terms of feasibility and the possibility, not talking about the high tech.
No, we don't want to talk about high tech. We only want to tell that is a, how much of a high tech information is required if the patient comes to you for the first time with a hypertension. Understanding their situation. What is the problem? What is the reason for your hypertension? It doesn't need any high tech information. How much of a high tech information is required to do a routine urine testing? And using a calculator in your office. And this is all available on web. Yes, very simple things. We want to reach out to GPs more and more.
That's what I want to tell you. Though you say it's all simple.
Yes.
And today, in reality, how many GPs knows about these simple things? Even?
We want to reach out to GPs more, and that is the reason all three of us are working together also. Although at a very small level, we didn't take any, you know, it's only going by word of mouth what we are doing. Help us, sir. We'll be more than happy to do that.
Sorry, I just want to make one small comment with regards to your question. He says most of the normal ranges for most of the parameters that we are based on Western literature. So we really don't have good quality studies which actually looked at the normal ranges for, you know, things like creatinine and so on. Whatever the lab standard is based on Western practice, it's not necessarily modified to our population. That is why we have to be even more careful with regards to some of the normal ranges. You know, they may refer to
When we do not have any guidelines, some guideline is better than anything else, and that is where this is. Also, you are right that the MDRD equation was also tried to validate in Chinese population, Japanese population, and everywhere they had to add another factor to it. So in Indian population, it is not really validated to the things. However, it is better than nothing. That's where we stand.
Ma'am, with the diabetes and hypertension being the two most important causes for the CKD, how often should we screen the patients for CKD, and what are the basic tests that we can do to screen for CKD in a general population with diabetes and hypertension?
Okay. First time the patient comes to you, please ensure whether it's a primary hypertension or secondary hypertension. And diabetes also, first time when they come to you, just ensure whether it is a very long standing or not, and which are the end organs that are affected. For that is number one, first level. After that, every 3 months once is good enough. Okay, and when compared to diabetes, of course, the HbA1c every 3 months is a must to be able to ensure that the kidney progression doesn't happen faster. and urine analysis, which will give you pick up the early albumin levels. And if the routine dipstick actually picks up only if it is more than 300 milligrams. And if you are in suspicion, the sugars have not been under control, and the urine dipstick is not picking up anything, then you can even do a microalbumin. That means if the protein is less than 300 milligrams, but definitely more than 30. As you can see in the staging part, we put that as an A2. This one, I don't know how. Can I put this thing on for this one as a main?
You want to this slide?
This slide. As you can see here, the CKD is based on the amount of protein loss. Also, here, normally you see about. Normally you see less than, normal is less than 30 milligrams. Once it is more than 30 but less than 300, we call it a microalbumin. The dipstick picks up only when it is more than 300. So in a doubtful patients with a higher risk factors, you screen them early for an albumin loss. That is also a marker for kidney problem. Okay, why? Because higher the amount of protein loss, the progression is much faster. Okay, and what is this really protein albumin or the protein loss tells you is that the lining of the endothelium is getting damaged. So anything that is supplied through all the organs is through the endothelium, blood vessels only. No? So if the endothelium is affected, then naturally that is a marker for a intervention early, aggressive intervention. So every 3 months once you can do that, and urine routine to begin with. Creatinine also every 3 months, fasting lipid profiles you do. Once you do a scan, especially in older population, so you want to rule out the other things like a prostate problems, retention of the urine, kidney stones, and things like that. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sharita. If there are no further comments or questions, I think we can ask Dr. Shivalingam to come on stage. We're running short of time. We are delayed half an hour. We would like to discuss more of these questions, especially if you have, some of you have more questions on creatinine estimation, GFR estimation, etc., comments, etc. We can always talk to us in the break or even after that also.